ओमज्ञान्तिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदामय्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातां सहगणा रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणा ललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितंश्च। हे कृष्णा करुणासिन्धु दीनबन्धु जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकाकांत राधाकांत नमोस्तुते। तप्तकांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी दशभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिये। वंचकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यश्च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंदा। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामो राम रामो हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू ऑल फॉर आवर गीता क्लास। So today we are doing a session on chanting the holy names, on how to chant the Mahamantra, especially on beads. So we'll be teaching you all this. We will explain to you the entire science of chanting. So today we are taking a break from our regular Gita class, the first chapter that we are discussing. We will continue that from the next week. So today's session is going to be very important, something that's very practical, that you all can do every day in your life, because the Gita philosophy is just not meant for understanding and with our intelligence. It is also meant to apply what we have understood. So in today's class, we are going to teach you the practical application. So just like in our Journey of Self-Discovery course, we ended the course by explaining four things: A, B, C, D. A is association, B is books, C is chanting, D is diet, Krishna Prasad. So today we are going to focus on C, chanting. The association is happening. You all are all coming for the weekly satsang. That is wonderful. The books also is happening to some extent. We are discussing from the Gita. Hopefully the Gita classes are helping you all appreciate the wisdom of Gita so that you all can connect to this book. So today we are going to discuss on chanting. So today's session is called Deepening Your Connection with Krishna. So this symbol is quite familiar to everyone, the Wi-Fi symbol, the internet symbol. In today's time of lockdown, you know, where everyone is practically at home, the most important thing is the connection, isn't it? Internet connection. If that internet connection is not there, if that signal is less, then we become very agitated. Why? Because we want to remain connected with others. Similarly, just like we are very excited and eager that we remain connected with others, it is very important that we remain connected with Krishna also. We remain connected with God. So just like you have a mobile so that you can remain connected with others, what is the process through which you can remain connected with Krishna always? That is what we are going to discuss in today's session. So we'll begin with this verse from the Gita. This is the 8th chapter, the 5th verse. Very important verse. Antakale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram ya prayati samadbhavam yati nasti atra samshaya. So this is a very beautiful verse, a very important verse in the 8th chapter. Krishna says, and whoever at the end of his life quits his body remembering me alone, at once attains my nature. Of this there is no doubt. So Krishna is saying here, antakale cha mam eva. So at the end of one's life, one who remembers me, smaran muktma kalevaram. So one, smaran means remembering. So Krishna is saying, one who remembers me when at the time of death, antakale. So what will be the result? Such a person will attain my nature, or he will attain my abode. Yati nasti atra samshaya. So Krishna is saying, there is no doubt about this. So what is Krishna saying here? We have to live our life in such a way that at a last moment we can think about Krishna. So Srila Prabhupada writes a very beautiful purport of this shloka in this verse. I will read that purport, which is very relevant to today's discussion. In this verse, the importance of Krishna consciousness is stressed. Anyone who quits his body in Krishna consciousness, it is at once transferred to the transcendental nature of the Supreme Lord. So Krishna is saying here that anyone who quits his body in Krishna consciousness, what is Krishna consciousness? Always thinking about Krishna. Such a person is transferred to the spiritual world. The Supreme Lord is the purest of the pure. So Krishna is the purest of the pure. Therefore, anyone who is constantly Krishna conscious is also purest of the pure. So what is the process to become pure? If we are in touch with that all pure God, Krishna, we will also become pure. The word smaran, remembering, is important. So in this entire shloka, the word what is important? Smaran. What we remember, what we think, what is the subject matter of our thoughts. So remembrance of Krishna is not possible for the impure soul who has not practiced Krishna consciousness and devotional service. So who can remember Krishna? Because Krishna is all pure, only someone who is pure can remember Krishna. That means remembrance of Krishna is not very easy. Someone may say, "Arey, I will remember Krishna at the end of my life." Is it that easy? It's not that easy. What you remember at the end of your life, what you have practiced throughout your life, that's what you will automatically remember. There is the story of Akbar and Birbal. So there was one guy who came to the court of Akbar, and he was speaking so many languages, practically hundreds of languages he knew, all the languages of India. And he was speaking every language fluently. So he challenged Akbar, "Can you tell me what is my mother tongue?" So Akbar was thinking, how do I tell? He's speaking every language so fluently, perfectly. Birbal said, "Don't worry, I will find out what his mother tongue is." So in the night when this guy was sleeping, so Birbal dressed himself as a ghost and went there. So when in the middle of the night, Birbal sees Birbal in the form of a ghost. He gets so shocked. He naturally starts to speak in his mother tongue. His mother tongue naturally comes out. Why? Because what is ingrained in us, in a difficult moment, it will come out. So similarly, Krishna is saying, what will come out at the time of death? If a ghost is fearful, I mean, death is the most fearful thing. It's very scary. So what's going to come out at the time of death? Just one second. So what will come out at the time of death? Whatever we have practiced throughout our life will naturally be our thought at the time of death. So that's why Srila Prabhupada is saying, remembrance of Krishna is not easy for one who has not practiced Krishna consciousness throughout your life. So we are connecting the dots. So basically Krishna is saying here, someone has to remember me at the time of death. So Srila Prabhupada is saying, remembering Krishna is not easy. To remember Krishna, we have to practice throughout our life. And what does the practice mean? Therefore, one should practice Krishna consciousness from the very beginning. And what is the practice? If one wants to achieve success at the end of his life, the process of remembering Krishna is essential. So if we want to make our life very successful, we have to practice remembering Krishna. And what does remembering Krishna mean? Therefore, one should constantly, incessantly chant the Maha Mantra, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So how does one remember Krishna? by practicing to remember Krishna. And what is the mean of what it means to practice remembering Krishna? It means to constantly, incessantly chant the Maha Mantra, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So in this verse, Srila Prabhupada is stressing the importance of chanting the holy names. So in today's session, we are going to discuss a little more about the science of chanting. So the scriptures explain, there's this beautiful verse that comes, Krite yat dhyayato Vishnum, Tretayam yajato Make, Dvapare paricharyayam, Kalau tad hari kirtanat. So for every yuga, there is a certain way in which one can perfect his life and achieve the supreme. So it says, Krite yat dhyayato Vishnum. So Krite means Satya Yuga. So we all know there are four yugas, Satya, Treta, Dwapar, Kali. So in Satya Yuga, the way of achieving perfection is Dhyayato Vishnum, to sit with Dhyan. So that's why you have Vishwamitra Muni and you know all these sages who would like meditate for thousands and thousands of years. So that was Satya Yuga, Dhyana. So that was the process of achieving the Lord. In Treta Yuga, the process was Tretayam Yajato Makhe. In Tretayam, in Treta Yuga, you do Yajna, big Yajna. So Treta Yuga is the Yuga where Lord Ram appears. So there is huge arrangement of Yajna Kund that is done. Practically, this Yajna Kund will be as big as football stadiums, cricket stadiums. Huge Yajna Kund with so many Brahmanas and you know, very opulent celebrations. So that was the process of achieving the supreme Yajna. Dwapare paricharyaya. So in Dwapar Yuga, the way to achieve perfection was paricharyaya. That means deity worship. Constructing big temples, worshipping the deities. That was the way of achieving perfection in Dwapar Yuga. Kalau tad hari kirtanat. So in Kali Yuga, the way of achieving perfection is chanting the holy names. Kalau tad hari kirtanat. Chanting the names of Krishna, doing kirtan of Krishna. That is the process of Kali Yuga. So in Kali Yuga, can we do dhyana? People may say, you know, we can do meditation, but how long can we sit and do meditation without our mind getting disturbed? It's very difficult. Mind is like everywhere. So it's very difficult to do dhyana. So sit for 5-10 minutes together at one place without moving, it's so difficult for people of Kali Yuga. Especially with internet and WhatsApp, you know, your hands are always fidgety, right? It's very difficult. Tretayam yajatomake. Is it possible in Kali Yuga to do huge yajnas? Very difficult to do huge yajnas. You need a lot of ingredients. You need the proper ghee. Where is pure ghee hardly available? Where is the right kind of brahmanas who chant right kind of mantras? Very difficult to find. So it's very difficult in Kali Yuga to do yajna also. Dwapare paricharyayam. Is it easy in Kali Yuga to do deity worship? That's also very difficult. For deity worship, your cleanliness standards have to be very high. You have to take bath 2-3 times a day. You know, proper, you have to follow all the rituals properly. Very, very difficult. So Kali Yuga, Krishna lowers down. So if in Satya Yuga, you know, it's like you get 25% discount to achieve the Lord. But in Kali Yuga, people don't have the money, even if the product is offered with 25% discount to achieving the supreme abode of the Lord. Very difficult for people to buy in Kali Yuga. So in Treta Yuga, it's like 50% discount. Dwapar Yuga is 75% discount. But Kali Yuga people, when Krishna comes and tells, okay, 75% discount, you take this product of bhakti, you know, of spiritual life. Very difficult for people of Kali Yuga. So Krishna says in Kali Yuga, 100% discount. I have made the process very simple. What you have to do? Just open your mouth and chant the names of Krishna. Kalau tad hari kirtanat. Just like na, you have a student who, he doesn't study at all. You know, so you tell the student passing mark, 75%. He says very difficult. 50% very difficult. 35% also the student can't get. So the teacher says, don't worry, you come to the examination hall, just write your name on the paper, I will pass you. So that is the condition of people of Kali Yuga. Very difficult to achieve perfection. But the Lord is so merciful. He's made the process so low, so easy that anyone can take up. Kalau tad hari kirtanat. That is why the scriptures say in Kali Yuga, the process of achieving God is kirtan, to be chanting the names of the Lord. So what is meditation and what is mantra japa that we are talking about? Meditation ultimately means meditating on the Supreme. So when someone says that I am closing my eyes and meditating, what are you meditating on? Meditation always has to have an object of meditation. You can't say I'm meditating. What are you meditating on? So I'm meditating on nothing. That's not the ideal form of meditation. Meditation means there has to be an object of your meditation. You have to meditate on someone. And the best, and the scriptures explain that meditation means meditation on the Supreme Lord, Vishnu or Krishna. And mantra meditation, what we are going to teach you all today, is the highest form of meditation. What does mantra mean? Mantrayate iti mantra. That chanting, repeating the syllables that helps us conquer the mind is called mantra. So by chanting the names of Krishna, our mind also becomes very regulated and peaceful. It's like a byproduct that automatically happens. So that is why mantra meditation is considered to be the highest form of meditation, especially for the people of Kali Yuga. So someone may question, why Hare Krishna Maha Mantra? There are so many other mantras. Why only Hare Krishna Mantra? Because it's not because ISKCON is preaching it, but it's mentioned in the scriptures. There are so many verses that come to explain why Hare Krishna Mantra is called the Maha Mantra. So what does Maha Mantra mean? Maha Mantra means something that's very big. Like previously you used to have Kola, you know, and then you came up with Maha Kola. Maha Kola means like the biggest, you know. So like that, Maha Mantra means a mantra in which all everything else is included. Just like if you have a 1,000 rupee note, in that 1,000 rupee note, 10 rupee note, 100 rupee note, everything is included. So similarly, by chanting the Maha Mantra, all other mantras are included in the Maha Mantra. So this is the last words of Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam, you know, it's like the postgraduate study. After you study the Gita, you know, then you enter into Srimad Bhagavatam, which contains the pastimes of the Lord. The Gita has 700 shlokas. The Bhagavatam has 18,000 shlokas. But what is the last words of the Bhagavatam? Any book you read, the conclusion is always at the last. So what is the last words of the Bhagavatam? Nama Sankirtanam Yasya Sarva Papa Pranashanam Pranamo Dukkha Shamanas Tam Namamim Harim Param. So it says, Nama Sankirtana Yasya Sarva Papa Pranashanam. So the chanting of the holy name of Krishna, Nama Sankirtan, destroys all sin. Sarva Papa Pranashanam Pranamo Dukkha Shamanas Tam Namamim Harim Param. It reduces all our suffering, relieves us all our suffering. So that's why it is explained in the Bhagavatam. I offer my obeisances, Tam Namami Harim Param. I offer my obeisances to the Supreme Lord Hari, who's come in the form of His holy name. So Chaitanya Charitamrit is another scripture, you know, which speaks about the glories of the holy name. So this is a very famous verse that comes in the Chaitanya Charitamrit. Harir Nama, Harir Nama, Harir Namaiva Kevalam, Kalo Nasteva, Nasteva, Nasteva Gatir Anyata. So it says here, Harir Nama, Harir Nama, Harir Namaiva Kevalam. In this age of Kali, the only means of deliverance is chanting the holy name, chanting the holy name, chanting the holy name. Harir Nama, Harir Nama, Harir Nama, Eva Kevalam. Only. So it is explained three times, stressed three times. Only the holy name, only the holy name, only the holy name. So someone may say, is there any other way? Again, it is stressed three times. Kalo nasteva, nasteva, nasteva gatidanyata. No other way, no other way, no other way. Can you imagine? Three times it is stressed positively and three times it is stressed in a negative connotation. Only the holy name, only the holy name, only the holy name. No other way, no other way, no other way. So why is it repeated so many times in this one verse? Because when you want to emphasize something, you repeat. Just like a judge says, when there's a lot of noise in the court, he says, silence, 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 or order, order, order. That means pin drop silence. Or a teacher tells in the class, silent, silent, silent. Please sit down, sit down, sit down, or whatever. Three times you explain. So whenever you repeat three times, that means you're very serious about this matter and you're emphasizing the subject. So that's why in this verse, it is three times explained only the holy name. So this is a very beautiful verse that comes in the scripture, which explains where this Mahamantra comes. So this is an Upanishad called Kali Santaran Upanishad, where Narad goes to Brahma and asks Brahma that for people of Kali Yuga, what, and people of Kali Yuga are suffering so much. Probably Narad could predict that in 2020 there is going to be COVID and all these things. So Narad is asking Lord Brahma that for the people of Kali Yuga, what is that hope for them so that they can get rid of all their sufferings and achieve the perfection? So there in Kali Santaran Upanishad, Brahma gives this Mahamantra. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So this mantra is there in the Upanishads. And then he says, Iti Shodashaka Nam Nam, Kali Kalmash Nashanam, Nata Paratara Upaya, Sarva Vedesha Drishyate. Since this chanting of the mantra, of this combination of the mantra, the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, is the only way in which the misgivings of Kali Yuga can be destroyed. Kali Kalmash Nashanam can destroy all the misgivings of Kali Yuga. Nata Paratara Upaya. So this is who is speaking this? Brahma is speaking. Brahma is the greatest authority. He is the one who compiled the Vedas. So he is saying there is no other way. Nata Paratara Upaya. Sarva Vedesha Drishyate. This is the opinion of all the Vedas. This is the opinion of all the Vedas. So this is the conclusion of all Vedic scriptures. Whether it is the Gita, the Bhagavatam, the Chaitanya Charitamrita, any scripture you pick up, they will tell you the essence is Vedanta. The conclusion of all Vedas is to chant the holy names of Krishna. Kale dosha nide rajan asti eka mahanguna kirtana deva krishnasya bukta sangha param vraje. This is another shloka that comes in the Bhagavatam, which says, O Parikshit Maharaj, Sukhdev Goswami is telling this to Parikshit, that in this age of Kali, it is filled with an ocean of faults. But there is one great quality of Kali Yuga. And what is that? By chanting the holy names, one can attain liberation. So how does the Hare Krishna Mahamantra work? How does Hare Krishna work? So just like a fish, the fish, if it is separated from water, the fish is not going to be happy. Whatever you give the fish, it's not going to be happy. The only thing that the fish wants is water. So life is very simple. If we can connect to what our original nature is, the life of a fish is very simple. The fish doesn't need very complicated stuffs. It doesn't need very trendy and flashy stuffs. What the fish needs is simple, plain water. And it's happy. So in the same way, we are all like this fish. And what we need is water for survival, so that we feel nourished. And what is that water? That water is our connection with God. And how does that connection to God happens? By chanting the holy names of God. So for us, chanting the Mahamantra is like a fish being put in water again. The fish automatically feels satisfied. So how does the Mahamantra work? The Hare Krishna mantra connects us back to our original nature, puts us in touch with Krishna, and automatically we start to experience bliss and satisfaction. So what is the meaning of the Mahamantra? Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. What is the meaning of this mantra? So in this mantra, there are three words, Hare, Krishna and Rama. Krishna and Rama refer to the Supreme Lord. Hare refers to Radha Rani, just like we say Radha, Krishna, or Sita, Ram. It refers to the consort, the energy of the Lord, his feminine counterpart. So this is a prayer. What is the meaning of the Mahamantra? This Mahamantra is a prayer to Krishna. O Krishna, O Radharani, please engage me in your service. Till now, I have been trying to serve Maya, illusion, my own senses, my own mind, and I'm not happy. For so many lifetimes I have served. Now my prayer is, please engage me in your service. I want to serve you. So that is the meaning of the Mahamantra. So while we chant the Mahamantra, we can pray in this mode that, O Lord, please pick me up and engage me in your service. That is the meaning of the Mahamantra. So why is the holy name powerful? So this is a verse that comes in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. Naam nama kari bahudha nija sharva shaktis tatrapita niyamita smaranena kalaha. So it says, naam nama kari bahudha nija sharva shaktis, that Krishna has put all his energy into the holy names. All his shakti is in the holy names. Sarva shaktis. So just like, what is the difference between the names of Krishna and ordinary names? Just like if you are thirsty, you say water, water, water. You keep chanting, you know, 108 times you keep chanting, water, 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 pani, pani, pani. Will your thirst be quenched? No. Because the name water and the actual object water are two different things. That's the material objects. But for the spiritual objects, for the Supreme Lord, it's not like that. The name Krishna and Krishna are the same. Nama namino abhinnatvam. There is no difference between the name of Krishna and Krishna. Why? Because the Lord is omnipotent. What does omnipotent mean? Anything connected to him has the same potency. So because the name of Krishna is in connection with Krishna, the name of Krishna is also very powerful. So why is the holy name powerful? Because the holy name is the name of the Lord. So that's why Krishna has invested all his strength in the holy names. That means by being in touch with the holy names of Krishna, we are actually in touch with Krishna. So if Krishna is God, why do we use Hare? As I told you, Krishna refers to the Supreme Lord and Hare refers to his counterpart, the feminine aspect, his consort. So this is like an eternal mother and father. So Krishna is like the Supreme Father and Hare refers to Radha. So it is the invocative way of explaining, telling Radha. Hare is another name for Radha. So when we say Hare Krishna, what we are trying to say is Radha Krishna, Radhe Krishna. So why do we use Hare? Because, and we use Hare before we chant Krishna also, Hare Krishna. Because to get the mercy of the Supreme Lord, we always have to go through the channel of the Supreme Mother. Even like in mundane, even in our normal life, you know, many times the fathers are very strict. So if a child wants to get something done from the father or want to buy something and the father is not ready to listen, so it's a very simple way. The child goes to the mother and tells the mother, mummy, you know, I want this. And the mother tells the father, just give him now, why you're troubling him so much. And the father gives. So similarly, Mother Hare, Radharani, is more merciful than Krishna. So when we chant Hare along with the names of Krishna, then it becomes full. And we get the mercy of the Lord much more easily. So that's why the word Hare is used. So what is the meaning of the word Rama? Yeah, so the scriptures explain that there are three Ram. One is Ayodhyapati Ram, Lord Ramachandra, the son of Dasharath. Then there is Balaram, the brother of Krishna. And then there is Parshuram, another avatar of the Lord. So this Ram could mean any of the three. But generally, Ram here also means the name Krishna only. In one sense, Krishna and Ram are non-different. So Ram, what is the meaning of Rama? Rama means pleasure, the source of all pleasure. So the God who gives all pleasure is called Rama. So it can refer to Krishna, it can refer to Ram, right? But the acharyas explain here that the Ram in the Mahamantra that we chant also refers to Krishna. So one of the name of Krishna is also Radhika Ramana, Radha Ramana. So Ramana means one who enjoys. So that is the meaning of the word Rama. So the next important aspect in chanting is, many people have this question, why do we keep count? Like, you know, this is the beads, you know, that we have. So, you know, in these beads, there are 108 beads in this, and devotees chant, you know, there is one mala of 108 beads. So we keep count. Many devotees chant one round, two rounds. Many devotees chant 16 rounds, those who are serious. So someone might say, why do we keep count? Main aise hi jab karta rahunga na, count rakhne ki kya zarurat hai? Keeping count is a science. So we chant in a specific way. You know, initially you may start with one round, two rounds, and gradually increase. But why keep count? Because it gives us a sense of consistency and discipline. Without keeping count, you will not have any discipline. Sometimes you may be in mood, you may chant 100 times. Sometimes you may not be in mood, you may not chant, right? So keeping count keeps us, it's the minimum. It's not that the rounds that we chant are maximum, it's the minimum. So that at least in the day, whatever comes, we do that minimum round. Just like even athletes, no? When people practice for Olympic, you know, in running and everything, they keep a timer with them and they count. They, you know, they keep their own records. So counting is something that's very important. All our acharyas in our parampara have been counting this number of rounds they chant. So why 108 beads are there in a mala? Why not 109? Why not 107? Because 108 is considered an auspicious figure in our Vedic scriptures. So it is explained that there are 108 principal gopis of Krishna. There are 108 Upanishads. There are 108 holy places, Divyasthali. Like this, there are a lot of, there is a lot of mahima of keeping 108 in the beads. So why 16 rounds, as I told you, like all of you all, those who are new, you all can at least try to chant one round every day to begin with, which will take you around 10 minutes. But as devotees progress, they all try to come to this level of 16 rounds. So why 16 rounds? Because it is explained that, you know, in a day, there are 24 hours in a day. So at least out of 16 rounds will take you 2 hours almost, right? So at least if Krishna has given us so many hours, 24 hours a day, we can give him at least something in return. So 16 rounds is the bare minimum. What Krishna tells in the Gita is satatam kirtayanto mam. One should actually be chanting constantly, but at least 16 rounds we should aim for. Gradually you all can try to for that. So many people have this question also. Should we chant 4 rounds with full devotion or 16 rounds with half devotion? Main 4 mala pura focus ke saath karun ki 16 mala karun, figure kar dun 16 mala ka, par utna dil ke saath nahi, utna dhyan ke saath nahi. What is the best option? So the best option is to chant 16 rounds with full devotion. It is like asking, aapko एक चपाती चाहिए, अच्छा वाला चपाती चाहिए, फर्स्ट क्लास वाला एक चपाती चाहिए कि उतना अच्छा नहीं, ओके टाइप चपाती चार चाहिए, क्या चाहिए आपको? यू वॉन्ट वन चपाती विच इज लाइक रियल गुड क्वालिटी और यू वॉन्ट फोर चपाती विच आर नॉट वेरी गुड क्वालिटी? व्हाट यू विल से, आई वॉन्ट फोर चपाती ऑफ गुड क्वालिटी. दैट मीन्स व्हाइल ईटिंग we want quality also, we want quantity also, correct? Similarly, with bhakti to Krishna, with chanting to Krishna, we need both. We need quality also, we need to do good rounds, but we also need to do quantity rounds, we need to do more rounds also. So quality versus quantity, which is more important? Both are important, but and both support each other. So if you chant good quality rounds, you will want to do more. And if you chant more, you will also want to improve your quality. So both help each other. So we need to do our rounds also. We need to do them well also. Okay. This is another very important question many people have. How do I find time to chant? My life is so busy. How do I find time to chant? The point is, we need to make a priority. Just like Krishna is saying in this verse we read, antakale cha mam eva. So Krishna is saying that, you know, to remember him at the time of death, one needs to practice. And whatever you have practiced, you'll remember at the time of death. So we need to find time for chanting. And from where do we get time? We can save all the time that we waste around, isn't it? There's so much time we waste in internet and WhatsApp and on so many things. We waste time in chit-chatting and seeing news, which really doesn't help us in many ways. So we need to remove the time and put it into chanting. So investing in chanting is the best use of time. The rest, everything might be a waste, may really not help us. But chanting of the holy names will definitely help us. So how do I find time to chant? First is we need to make a priority. And how do you make a priority? When we understand the importance of something, we will find time. However busy we are, we find time to eat, isn't it? We don't say, I'm too busy, I don't have time to eat. We don't say, I'm too busy, there's no time to sleep. However busy you are, we eat, sleep, we do all these things. Why? Because we know it's important. If I don't do it, I will not be able to survive. So similarly, how do I find time to chant? By understanding it's a priority. It is something that's very important to me. So what are the rules of chanting? The first is, one should be in a prayerful mood. The mood is very, very important. Chanting is just not a ritual to get it done. Maine mala khatam kar diya. I finished my rounds. No, that's not the mood. The mood is something that's very important. So that's why Krishna is called Bhavagrahi Janardana. Krishna accepts the mood. So what is the right mood to chant? We should be chanting in a mood of desperation. Like a child who is disconnected, is crying for his mother. The mother has left the child and gone. How will the child cry for the mother? Very desperately. You have seen a child crying. The child cries really desperately. And when the mother hears that cry, she comes running. Just like that story is there of Draupadi being disrobed by Dushasana in that assembly. How does Draupadi cry? Draupadi raises both her hands and cries out the names of Krishna. And that's when Krishna comes. It's a prayerful mood, helpless mood. She knows that without Krishna, no one can help me. So in this world, just like Draupadi is being disrobed by Dushasana, this world is filled with Dushasans who are trying to trouble us, torture us in so many ways. And what can we do? Draupadi had the best, the most powerful 5 husbands. They couldn't help her. With her own strength, she couldn't help her. She understood that only Krishna can help me. Similarly, when we understand that it's only Krishna that can help us, and Krishna has come in the form of the holy names, then we chant the holy names very sincerely in that prayerful mood. And just like if someone is drowning in an ocean and someone throws a rope, how will that person hold that rope? No, it's not that he will hold that rope and in one hand talk on a mobile phone. No, he'll hold the rope very tightly because he knows that if I leave this rope, I'm gone. If I leave this rope. So similarly, we have to hold on to the chanting very tightly and in a very prayerful mood that only Krishna, you can help me. Hey Krishna, Karuna Sindhu. Krishna, you are very merciful. I'm drowning in this ocean of birth and death. Please pick me up. So the prayerful mood is very important. Second rule of chanting is to pay attention. So this is something that's very crucial. So while we chant the Maha Mantra, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. What we have to do, should we visualize a picture of Krishna? We don't have to do all that. What we have to do is, what we chant, the mantra that we chant, the name of Krishna, we have to hear attentively. Listen attentively. So the 3 most things in chanting is listen, listen, listen. Listening is something that is very important. So chant distinctively and listen attentively. So this is the way chanting works. When we chant properly and we allow the mantra to enter our ear, the mantra of the names of Krishna enter our hearts and purify our heart. So paying attention is very important. Like in school, all our teachers have been teaching us this. In all our school days, one instruction that we have always heard, what is that? Pay attention. Listen carefully. Don't get distracted. Isn't it? We have heard this practically in every class. First standard, second standard, till 10th standard, probably beyond that also. Pay attention. So this is also very important in chanting. Pay attention. Just like if Narendra Modi comes to your house, the Prime Minister, how will you receive him? You will receive him very carefully, no? It's not that he's come to your house, he's there and sitting in front of you, and you're watching WhatsApp. No, you understand that he is an important person. Every moment of it is his is very important. So very careful you are in taking care of him, in talking to him very respectfully, because you know attention is very important. So similarly, who is Krishna? What is the holy name? The holy names are the names of Krishna. And who is Krishna? Krishna is like much more powerful than millions of Narendra Modis, isn't it? So when Krishna is, this is a private time with Krishna. So when we are there with Krishna, we have to be attentive to him. We can't be distracted everywhere. And the third is proper pronunciation. We have to pronounce the holy names very, very clearly and distinctively. So these are three rules of chanting. Prayerful mode, we need to pay attention, and proper pronunciation. So what is a good speed to chant? Should I chant fast? Should I chant slow? What should I do? Best is to chant at a good medium pace. So everyone by practice, you know, you will understand what is like your best speed for you. For some people, if they chant too slow, they find that their mind wanders too much. Some people, when they chant too fast, they find that they are skipping some words of the mantra. So you have to have a good speed, but more important than speed is two things, that you have to pronounce clearly and hear attentively. So if your speed is distracting you from listening, then it is, you have to be very careful of that. So the speed is not so much important. What is important is whether we are chanting properly and listening attentively. So one should not look, keep looking in the watch, you know, I'm thinking, arey, time ho gaya, mala khatam karna hai, mala khatam karna hai. That's not the right mode. So while chanting, you should keep the watch aside and just chant. Even if it takes a little longer, it doesn't matter. No, Krishna will take care. Krishna is the master of time also, right? Krishna tells in the Gita that I am time. So Krishna is time. Time is one of his energy. So if you're chanting the names of Krishna, Krishna will arrange other things in your rest of your time. So speed, a good speed is, many people say, you know, it's like 7 to 8 minutes. It's considered a decent speed for one round. But more than speed, what is important is our quality. Is it okay to chant in mind? Should I have to chant audibly, or can I just chant in my mind? Yes, chanting in the mind is a very high stage. But what at our level, what is most important is that we chant loudly, audibly enough so that we can hear. We need not be like very loud in the chanting, but it should be audible so that we can hear. That is what is important. What is the best time and place to chant? The best time to chant is in the morning hours. That's like the best time to chant. So ideally, you know, if you can get up a little early and then chant, it's like the best time, because the distractions are less. Your WhatsApp messages have not yet started. Your life is still not started. So that's the best time to chant. Just like, you know, before you take your mobile and do anything, you charge your mobile in the morning, right? You put it for charging. So similarly, the best time to charge your batteries is in the morning. Just like the example is given that if you have to travel from one place to another, ideally the best time to move is in the early morning hours when the traffic is less. The traffic is less, you can move very fast. So similarly, the mental traffic is very less in the morning. So that's the best time to chant. But if you can't do it due to some reason, we should not make that as an excuse not to chant in the day. We can make up in the day also. And what is the best place to chant? We can all create an atmosphere which is pleasant, which is spiritual, so that we can sit and chant. Ideally, a comfortable place, not too comfortable, because if it's too soft a place, you're sitting on a very soft bed or a sofa, you may doze off also. So little comfortable enough to sit and chant. And you can probably have a picture of Krishna in front of you, or a tulsi plant in front of you. So a very conducive, clean atmosphere, a simple atmosphere that can help you chant also. So what are the don'ts while chanting? Not many don'ts, but the most important don'ts is while chanting, at least don't look at your mobile. Keep your mobile aside. No internet, no WhatsApp, at least during chanting. You know, 10-15 minutes, whatever we give Krishna during chanting, let us not get distracted. No, so don't get into mobile, don't get into all these things. Just focus on your chanting. That's the most important thing. Can I chant any mantra? If you are already chanting, many people ask this question. If I am already chanting some mantra, what should I do? TK, you continue whatever you are chanting, but try to add the chanting of the Mahamantra. So what is the difference between Om and Hare Krishna? In one sense, both are the names of the Lord only. Om also is addressing the Supreme Lord only. But Hare Krishna is considered to be a more personal type of address. So Om is a more formal type of address. Hare Krishna is a more personal and intimate name of addressing, a way of addressing the Supreme Lord. Yeah. So what are the three benefits of chanting? First, by chanting the holy names, our heart gets cleansed. Cheto darpana marjanam. So, you know, our heart is filled with so many anarthas. Lust, anger, pride, greed, envy. There are so many things that are there in our heart because of which we don't experience happiness, peace. So the Mahamantra, what it does is, it goes and cleanses our heart. It goes inside our heart and the Mahamantra, the names of Krishna, cleanses our heart. And the heart actually becomes very pure. The second result of chanting is our constitution is established. So as spirit soul, we are all servants of Krishna. As Atma, we are all servants of Krishna, but we have forgotten that relationship with Krishna. So when we chant the holy names and we keep praying to Krishna, Krishna, please engage me in your service. Please make me your servant. In that way, we come back to our original nature. So just like that example is given, a rainwater which falls from the sky comes very impure. But when that impure water is passed through a filtration process, it becomes very pure again. So similarly, the chanting of the holy name is like the filtration process that brings our original purity and establishes us in our constitutional position. And the final result of chanting is it satisfies our spirit soul. We are all looking for that satisfaction, that happiness. We have tried so many things in life. So let us all try this chanting of the holy names for a month or two. We all can sincerely try. And I'm sure anyone who has ever taken up to this process of chanting has found a lot of benefit in it. You find a lot of satisfaction. As I gave you the example of that fish, to be satisfied in life, you don't need big things. You just need a simple life and your connection with God. So just like, you know, if you have a mobile phone, even if you have a simple mobile phone, but if you have good range, a mobile phone's purpose is solved. Similarly, if in life we have this connection with Krishna, if the chanting of the holy names of Krishna is there, automatically we will experience satisfaction. Just like that fish experiences satisfaction in the presence of water. So what is the effect of chanting? So the scriptures explain that sin personified also starts trembling in fear. So even if you have done unlimited papa, just by chanting the names of Krishna, all that sin goes away. The glory of material existence starts fading. So in front of the holy names of Krishna, all the pleasures of this world seem insignificant. Once we experience taste and experience the realizations of the holy name, we will find that this holy name is enough. I don't need anything else in my life. Yamaraja's tenotypist Chitragupta becomes happy and starts staring at the toenails of the chanter. So Yamaraj is the one who gives punishments and awards the future destination of living entity. And he has records of all our sins and punya and all that. But when someone takes up to the chanting of the holy names, Yamaraj also becomes very happy and, you know, starts to worship such a chanter. And finally, even the creator, Lord Brahma, starts making Madhupark to worship the chanter. So even demigods, Brahma, Shiva, and everyone becomes very happy when someone takes up to the chanting of the holy names. So that's why all the scriptures recommend this process of chanting the holy names of Krishna. So the way we do it is, as I showed you these beads. So we all have these beads. If you all want, we can try to see in what way we can arrange these beads for you all. So these are beads which 108 beads in this, a mala with 108 beads. So we hold the mala like this, you know, with these two fingers, we don't use this finger. And then we chant the Mahamantra. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Then the next one. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. like this. So we chant this entire mantra on this mala of 108 beats. It will take us around, if you are starting it new, it will take you around 10 minutes or something like that. But then slowly you will pick up the speed also. So this process appears to be a very simple process, but it's something that's very, very powerful. So for all devotees who have been with our movement for many years, many of them have been chanting for years together, and there is so much effect that this holy name produces. So many times we go through so many problems in life, so many crises in life, and we really don't have anyone to tell to. Sometimes you can't even tell your family members what you go through, you know. So one of the best ways, and in this world, everyone wants healing, right? Everyone wants to get healed. So the chanting of the holy names is the best way you can get healed. It is a private time with Krishna. We can pour out our heart to Krishna, you know, while we chant the Maha Mantra, and we can ask Krishna for his mercy, for his guidance. Everything that we are looking for is in the holy names of Krishna. But we have to try it. Just like there is a saying in English, the taste of the pudding is in the eating. So you will actually experience whatever we have spoken in this class today, the power of the holy names, only when you start chanting it. So my humble request to all of you all is that please try to chant these holy names at least one or two malas a day, 10-15 minutes. God has given us so much time in life, we can at least give him 10-15 minutes, right? So I'm seeing that all of you all are very regular for these classes. You all are all eager to understand the wisdom of the Gita. If you all can add the chanting to whatever you all are already attending these classes, it will make the classes much more meaningful. Why? Because Gita is not something that is just understood with your head. It is something that is to be experienced with our heart. And for us to experience that, we need a process so that the knowledge that we get in these classes can actually become wisdom in life. It doesn't remain on the level of the head, but it reaches the heart. And the way it can happen is through the process of chanting. So along with the Gita classes, along with the reading of Gita, if you can add this chanting, then the equation becomes perfect and we will experience a lot of transformation in our life. So anyone has any questions to what we discussed?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, please explain about the Mahatvatva beads, which is in the mala we have.
Pardon?
Mahatattva, the 109th bead, which we have in the mala.
Oh, we don't call it Mahatattva. We call it the Krishna Mani or the Guru Mani. So if you all see this bead, this is the extra bead that is there on top. So we don't chant on this bead. So we chant from the next bead and we move like this and we come to the end of this bead. And if you have to chant the next mantra, we start from where we stopped and we come back. It's like a pendulum, right? I'm having the bead here. So you move like this and you come here. The next bead, you go back like this. You don't cross this. You don't cross the bead. Yeah. Any other question?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Yeah.
A very motivating lesson. I've been chanting 16 rounds for many years. I have three questions, Prabhu. One is, I have this recording of Prabhu. With that audio recording, I chant. Is that okay?
Yeah, perfectly okay. You can do that, yeah.
That is one question. The other one is, when we go for walk and things like that, instead of the mala, can we use the counter?
Yeah, we can. Yeah. So ideally, the specific number of rounds that we are doing, like if you're doing 16 rounds or someone is just starting 3 rounds, 4 rounds, that many rounds we should try to do, if as far as possible, sitting in one place, you know, in a focused way. But all our extra rounds that we do, you know, while walking, we can carry that counter. You know? There is that counter machine that comes. That's perfectly okay. But it's not advisable that our regular rounds we do in that counter machine. It's not advisable.
And one last question, Prabhu. You say serve the God.
Yeah.
What all comes in serving the God?
Yeah, many things. But most important, when we say serve the God, we are speaking about that service attitude, that spirit of service.
See, what can we do to God? He has everything.
Exactly. Yeah, God has everything.
Serve the humanity or help the others?
Yeah. Your question is very nice that, yes, God has everything. What can we do to serve Him? Yes, we can't do anything for Him, but our service is only for our betterment. So we need to understand this that, by chanting Hare Krishna, it's not that we are doing Krishna a favor. We are doing a favor on ourselves only. So all our service is it's just a reciprocation of our love to Krishna. Just like a child, na? When a child wants to give a gift to a father, I mean, how does a child have a money of his own or her own? So the child takes money from the father and goes and buys gift and gives it back to the father. But the father is very happy with that gesture that at least that love is shown in some way. So if you love someone, you show it through the medium of service. Serve in some way.
Chanting, does it come under serving?
Exactly, it comes under service. Chanting is a very important aspect of service. Yeah.
And doing aarti.
Exactly, all that comes under service.
All this puja, things.
That comes under service, yeah. Even spreading this message across, preaching, helping others.
Book distribution.
Yeah, you were speaking about humanity. Yeah, so by connecting humanity to Krishna, that's one of the big service that you can do. So there are many things that come under service.
Thank you.
You can paint for Krishna.
Very much, Prabhuji.
Yeah.
Thank you. It was a very nice lesson. Will you be sharing this in your YouTube channel?
Yeah. They are doing the recording of this. Yeah.
Oh, thank you very much.
There is two questions in the chat. Is Radha a devotee? Yes, she's ultimately a devotee of Krishna. She's also the consort of Krishna. She's the energy of Krishna. So Radha shows us she's personification of bhakti. So when we want bhakti to Krishna, we pray to Radharani. She's like the goddess of bhakti, basically. So why do we keep the index finger away from the rest? Because for two reasons. One is it is explained that when we hold the beads like this, there is a nerve in this place that helps us focus. So in Vedic scripture, for everything that you do, there is a mudra that is there. Mudras are very important, right? Like when you sit to do meditation, you use this mudra like that. So for chanting, it is this mudra. There is an important aspect of using the beads like this. And why not the index finger? Generally, this is what I have heard, that we use the index finger to point out many defects of people. So generally we avoid the index finger.
Prabhuji, one more small question.
Yeah.
See, when we are doing a mala, generally in between one mala, we won't break.
Correct.
When a situation comes like that, you have to stop it for some urgent reason. Mm-hmm. Do we start from where we stopped or from the beginning?
Yeah. So if it's like very urgent that you're going to wind up the job in few seconds and you come back, then it's fine. You can hold the mala. But then if at any point it's going to take a long time in between the mala and you have to come back after some time, then better to chant the mala again. Restart it.
Okay, Prabhuji, thank you.
Yeah. So can we chant in the morning before taking bath? Best is if you can take a bath. But then if not, still advisable that you just wash your face and mouth and then start to chant. Yeah. But chanting in the morning is important. Yeah. Any other practical question? Anything that you all didn't connect to this class, what I explained, you all didn't understand, or any other thoughts that you all have? Please feel free to ask, because the more you you know, if you can clear your doubts and you get convinced, then you can actually take up this process also nicely. Okay, if no questions, then I have a question for you all. How many of you all will try chanting? How many of you all can try and would like to take up this? Great. Yes. Thank you, Vinay, Vaidya. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Me too.
I chant every day, Prabhuji.
Okay.
Okay. I chant 8 rounds, Prabhuji.
Okay. Okay. So someone is asking, Aruna Mataji, can you demonstrate slowly? Yeah. So this is the beads like this. These are the 108 beads. So this is the Guru Mani. We don't chant on this. So we chant in the next Mani like this. This. We hold the beads. We rest the beads on this finger. And with the thumb, I hold it like this. And I chant the mantra. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And the next. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Is this fine? So like this, you keep moving the beads. Good. So all of you all, please do try. As I told you, you all can try. If it doesn't work, you all can stop it. But there Guruji, is no harm in... Yeah.
Guruji, on Guru Mani, you can say Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda.
Yeah, yeah, you can do that.
And then continue.
Yeah, yeah, you can do that. Yeah.
Prabhu, once we start chanting, it won't let us stop.
Exactly. That's what.
Even for some reason, if you stop also, it will sort of prick us and bring us back. That's my...
Yeah.
Especially if I'm not well, I'm not able to do it, you know, I feel like, you know, something not all right.
Yeah.
And so one last question, Prabhu, I'm really bothering you today too much, I think. When we are not well, what do we do? Supposing I'm chanting 16 rounds. And I'm a senior citizen, 70 years old. The day I'm not well, what do I do? Do I make up the next day?
Ideally, you should never skip your rounds. We should try. If you're very, very sincere and you pray to Krishna, Krishna will give you the strength to chant. Even when you're not well, Krishna will give you the strength. So we should try our best sincerely. Even if you're sleeping on the bed, you can still move your hands and chant on mala. There's hardly any problem. No, you may have to take rest in between.
We can sit on the bed and chant.
Yeah. So if you're sick, then if you're sleeping in the bed, then it's fine. Perfectly fine. You lie down and you chant. But you chant. That's important.
Prabhuji, can we listen to the lectures and chant at the same time?
No. Don't do two things at the same time. No multitasking. So one thing, one time. If you're listening to lecture, listen to lecture. If you're chanting, chant. If you're eating prasad, have prasad. Don't do two, three things together. Not that the TV is in front, the mobile is in front and bead bag is in your hand. Please don't do that. You will not get benefit out of anything.
Okay.
If you want to hear a lecture, put down the beads, hear the lecture, then come back to chanting. So multitasking is not recommended in spiritual life. It's not recommended in life in general also. Okay. You know, most accidents in life happen because of multitasking. You all know that, na? While driving the car, if you pick up a phone, accident is inevitable.
Yes, Prabhuji.
While driving car, drive car, keep phone aside. If you want to attend the phone, park the car, attend the phone.
Okay, Prabhuji.
So similarly, in life, if you go spiritual life, while chanting, if you do many things, spiritual accidents will happen. Yeah. So, is chanting allowed for ladies even during their menstrual cycle? Yeah, it's allowed. No problem. What tips when someone gets distracted from chanting? Any tips? Yeah, the most important thing we will discuss now that I've introduced the topic for chanting. Probably in the Gita classes, you know, probably towards the end, 5 minutes, we can discuss about chanting. We'll give you all tips also. But what is the most important thing in chanting is when the mind wanders away, bring it back to hearing. Keep the process very simple. Chant and listen. So when the mind will naturally wander away, we have to bring it back to the sound of the holy name. So when the mind hears that sound, you will capture the mind back again. So it's like a practice. You know, you have to keep doing this again and again. Yeah, can we chant in the morning and evening half? Yes, surely you can chant. Okay, so very grateful to all of you all that you all took your precious time. And sorry that we had to shift the time to 7:45 today. But from the next week, we will continue our 7:15 timing. And we will continue the Gita from where we had stopped. The first chapter we will continue. But my request to all of you all is that please, right from tomorrow, please begin chanting. So please don't waste time. This is something that's very important. And important things, don't postpone. Shubh karya mein deri nahi. So right from tomorrow, please start chanting one round. And yes, from today we will do it. Perfect.
Prabhuji, tell us about your book, Prabhuji.
Oh, my book?
Today I ordered, I saw that.
Okay.
Little bit about your book.
Yeah. Basically, my book, this is called Happiness Revolution Through Consciousness Evolution. So we are all looking for happiness in life. So as I told you, as we are discussing in the class today also, happiness comes when we actually raise our consciousness. And raising our consciousness ultimately means raising our consciousness to Krishna, Krishna consciousness. You know, right now we are all in material consciousness. So when we shift back to our spiritual consciousness, so material consciousness is like the darker, lower consciousness. So when we slowly raise our consciousness to higher levels, automatically we will be happy. Like we discussed the effects of chanting also. One of the effects we saw is the soul experiences satisfaction. How? Because the consciousness is raising to a higher level. So in this book basically contains different themes, different topics. And in different topics, I have certain thoughts, certain sutras that I've mentioned, certain meditations of mine. So while reading this book, it will help us ponder. So each of these sutras are a little deep. You'll have to sit and think for some time, digest it. So and as this process happens, you know, you'll get a different way of thinking. And slowly you will feel that your consciousness is rising to spirituality, to Krishna consciousness, and then we naturally experience happiness. So basically this book is a compilation of all my meditations and my thoughts and sutras into thematic in various themes. That's how this book is made. Yeah.
Waiting for the book.
Yeah. Yeah, let me know how the book is once you get it. Okay, so let's end for today. So very happy that all of y'all have come. So we will meet on next Thursday, 7:15.